Hi everyone, my name is Kaitlyn Tonra and I am a research scientist at Oregon State University and a PhD student as well, and I study kelp. I study all kinds of algae, and today I'm going to tell you a little bit about that. I think if you're watching this, it means that you've been working with one of our lessons that involves using some data that I collected, and so this will be a chance for me to explain what that was about, why I did that, and what I learned from it. So hope you enjoy. Like I said, my name is Kaitlyn Tonra. I am a PhD student. So I, after high school and after college, went back to school. And so now I've spent the last 2 years doing my own research, taking upper level classes and learning more about how I can study the ocean. Here's some photos of what I do on a day-to-day basis. Up in the top left, you can see I'm out in the low tide zone. So when the tide goes out, that's called the intertidal zone. And there's tons of cool animals there. If you get a chance, I definitely recommend checking it out. I'm down there on the right too. That's just another photo of me out in the field. And then on the bottom left, you can see I'm scuba diving. So part of what I do is that I am a scientific scuba diver, which means that on top of all of my other certifications, like the open water and just knowing how to scuba dive like you would on vacation, I have extra training and all of this extra stuff I have to do to be able to do science underwater. So that means I can go down and drill into the bottom of the ocean. I can put out cages. I can do experiments down there that most people won't be able to do. So that's really fun and a big part of why I do what I do, because I love scuba diving and just seeing what's under the ocean. So one thing that I want to talk about before we get started into the actual data type conversation is to talk about what research is, because it's all that I do. It's my entire job. And since you guys are working on one of my research projects right now, I just want to go through and make sure that everybody knows what research means. Because I think this is a word that gets tossed around a lot in non-scientific circles as well, and can mean lots of things in day-to-day conversation. But for a research scientist, it's a very specific process most of the time. And it looks something like this. So when you start a project or a research goal, usually you start with an observation. So I have this photo on the right of me with a class from a few years ago doing some, we were just counting kelp in the intertidal. So those little palm tree things on the rock are little kelps. They're really cute. They're called postelsia. But in this case, the observation could be something like, these kelp grow on this side of the rock, but not somewhere else. Interesting thing to observe. So what we're doing in this case is we've gone out first, read a little bit about this. We've thought about it. You know, we saw this pattern. And then it's time to go check out the scientific literature. That is usually a really big job. That can take weeks and weeks or as much time as you have. There's tons of research papers out there in the tens of thousands probably. So it can be really daunting, but usually that reading involves using certain keywords to search for papers that are gonna be relevant and try to find out everything that any past researcher has done to answer a similar question. So once we've read all of our background information, we'll think of a question. And I kind of gave it away earlier, but the question here could be, why do these kelp grow in this place year after year? Or it could be something like, how tall on average are these kelp? And it could be as simple as that. And then the next thing is we think of ways to answer that question. So in this case, that would mean something like an experiment or a study. And what we're doing in this photo is we're just counting and measuring these little kelp. So we're going to end up with some numbers, some data that are going to tell us how tall on average they are, how many there are, and any other information that we think would be relevant to collect. So after you do all of this, we end up with just a mountain of data, tons of numbers, like in the spreadsheet that you'll be working with. And that's kind of the fun part, is that then we get to analyze it. And so then we get to have our numbers and take it from just plain data into an answer to a question that we're interested in. So in this case, maybe we'll end up knowing the average height is 6 centimeters or something. I don't know if that's true, but you end up getting a number, and then you know the answer to an environmental question that you have asked and found out on your own. And it's a really fun process. Usually by the end of this, you end up with even more questions and more observations because you've been spending so much time in the field thinking about it that you'll come back and say, well, I wonder how many blades they have. Those are kind of like the leaves on seaweed. So, you know, why are they this way? How are they attached to the rock? Do they only grow on certain surfaces? And then we start the whole thing over again. So that is the process of research. What I am most interested in is why species live where they live. And sometimes this is called distributional ecology or other things, but it's pretty much just understanding why do things appear where they do. And it sounds like a very basic question, but there are some really interesting answers to it. And that's what I do. So here you can see there's a photo of an intertidal zone. So that area when the low tide or the tide goes out when it's low tide. And there's some really neat patterns. So up the top, you can see that top area is all mussels and barnacles because those are the ones that can withstand being out of the water for the longest time. A little bit lower, we have kelp and some fleshy algae. So those are the things that need water a little bit more. So they can't be as high up, but they'll be fine for a little bit. So they're lower in the intertidal zone. And then at the very bottom, we have urchins and kelp, mostly urchins in this place. But those are the things that tend to be underwater all the time and that don't want to be as high up out of the water because they just can't deal with the drying out. So I have on the right here a list of some of these abiotic and biotic factors that influence where species can live. There's tons of them. This is just a few, but at least in the intertidal zone or underwater, some of the big ones are going to be drying out, sometimes called desiccation, disturbances like big logs coming through and knocking stuff off rocks, light and depth. Those are usually really tightly linked just because when you go underwater, it's darker. If you imagine the bottom of the ocean is pitch black. The surface is sometimes known as the substratum. So what surface things are living on, how salty the area is, what the temperature is, if it's too hot or too cold for certain species. And there's a bunch of other important ones like nutrients and competition. And herbivory, those ones tend to be more, herbivory and competition are more about interactions between species. So those are more biotic factors, but this is a huge list. But today I just want to focus on two of them. So we're going to be looking at light and depth, which like I said, are often the same thing. And then water flow, because that's a really important factor for delivery of oxygen and nutrients and just overall movement in the system. So, well, let's get started. This is just another example photo of this zonation, which is the process of organisms kind of stratifying and splitting up into different zones, depending on what combination of factors are best for them. I just think this is a neat photo. A lot of times this zonation takes place over, you know, 20 meters or about 60 feet in the intertidal zone where you have to walk pretty far to see this. But when you have a vertical surface, you can get this pattern just in, you know, a couple feet of height, which is really cool. So my main question that we're going to be looking at today and that you will end up looking at in your class when you work with this data is how do light and currents affect seafloor algae? So seafloor algae, I think, are super fun and super cool. Not everybody thinks that, but they're really neat. If you imagine a kelp forest is like a jungle or a forest that you can walk through on land, the algae that are below that are kind of similar to, you know, like bushes and shrubs that you would find in a forest. And you may not think those are the most important, but they take up a lot of space. They can provide some habitats and food. They just alter the way that water moves through a system. So there's lots of important aspects for why we study these, but I just think they're really neat and seaweed are really pretty. So I want to tell you about them. First, these are my sites. So I worked in Catalina Island, California, which is an island off the coast of sort of south of Los Angeles. It's near San Pedro, California. It's a really beautiful site. It's part of the Channel Islands National Park. I think it's a national park. And it's really neat. So Catalina Island was never attached to the mainland of California, which some islands are formed that way where the land was together and then splits off over, you know, geological timescales. I'm not sure how long, but Catalina itself was never a part of the mainland of the United States. So that means that a lot of the animals and plants that live out there can only be found on that island. So there's a lot of really cool plants and animals that you can't find anywhere else. And there's also a neat combination of animals because Catalina is at the southern end of a lot of species ranges and the northern end of a lot of other species ranges. So in this place where warm currents and colder currents come together and mix, you get a lot of species that normally you might find in Washington or in down in Mexico, but they can kind of coexist here because the water temperatures just mix in a cool way. So it's a great place. If you ever get a chance to visit, I would highly recommend it. But before we get into that, there's a few sites that I studied at that you might be familiar with now, but we have Bird Rock, which is pretty exposed. It's out away from the island, so it gets a little bit more water flow near it. Blue Cavern Exposed, or just Blue Cavern, also tends to get a lot more water flow because it's kind of on that outer part of this little point here. Perdition Caves over to the right side is more protected than Bird Rock or Blue Cavern because it gets a little bit sheltered from that little horn of land that's on top of it, but still a really neat site. And then Big Fisherman Cove, as you can tell, is in a cove. So that one's obviously a little bit more protected too. So the pink and yellow stars get less water flow. Things are a little bit slower there. And then the two blue stars get more water flow. Things are moving fast, currents are moving, and waves are a little bit more intense. So what I did is field surveys. And you might have looked at these photos and wondered, how did you take those photos? And this is how. So I found this milk crate on the left, you can see, in the trash. And I made a photo framer out of it. So this photo framer is really important because it helps me take photos that are at the same distance from the bottom. So I can be sure that in each picture, I'm getting the exact same amount of area. And even if it's not the same area, I know how much area there is in the photo. This will be more important in a minute when I talk about how I calculated the amount of how much of each species there was. But for now, that's how I did it. So I have my camera that I strapped on top. I had a light that I added on after this that's not in the photo. And then on the underside, I have a dive computer, which tells me how deep underwater I am. And it also, I had a compass that tells what direction I'm facing. And so there's a couple things you could do with this information. Mostly I just use depth for a lot of things, but you can also calculate something called a light index that just tells you how much light each photo, each actual quadrat is getting based on how deep underwater it is, what direction it's facing, and a few other things like sight. And that really helps to kind of pull apart some of the finer detailed aspects of each site and each quadrat. So one thing I want to point out is that a lot of times science seems like you need expensive gear or really fancy technology, but that's not always true. A lot of ecology you can do just by finding a basket in the garbage and making something out of that. So just throwing that out there, it's kind of a fun thing to do because it can be done by pretty much anyone. So that's how I did this. And I just want to give a quick shout out to some of my friends that helped me do this, and also to the fact that science is never done alone most of the time, especially scuba diving when you're in kind of a dangerous situation and you're driving boats and you're deep underwater. Always important to work with other people, and collaborating is a huge part of what I do every single day and in every single project. So this is my team that helped me do this, and it took us, I think, about 2 weeks to get all of this, all the photos taken, and it was a really good time, but a lot of work. So that's what it looks like. We were all scuba diving, so we all wear scuba gear and wetsuits. We carry lead weights and tons of gear. If you want to talk more about scuba diving, I would be happy to. You can send me an email. But yeah, so after we took all of these photos, we ended up with just tons of images. And you may have tried an exercise in class where you try to count how many different species there are and how many individuals there are. And if you did that, you might have noticed it's pretty difficult to tell individuals when it comes to seaweed because they don't always have clear individuals. So what I do to get around this is I use a software called CoralNet. It's a website called CoralNet, and it allows you to put random points onto a photo. So you can see, I don't know if you can see my mouse, but there's a lot of yellow dots on this photo. And what CoralNet does is it'll throw 75 dots onto each photo, or as many as you want. I use 75. And then I can go through and just identify what's underneath each point. And so this is a way of just having random points that allows me to estimate how much of each thing there is in each photo without doing individuals, because that can really get out of hand. So as you can see on the right, I identify everything species. So I know, and on the bottom, you can see my full list of everything. And I worked with seaweed exclusively. So everything in here is about algae, because that's by far the most common in what I was looking at. So overall, I had more than 5,000 points and tons of photos. These really add up. I had photos from 0 to 60 feet at a bunch of different sites, multiple transects per site. And a transect is just a line that you follow to take photos or do a survey. So multiple distances at multiple sites. It ends up being a lot of work, but we got it done. And now I can tell you about the answer to this question. How do light and flow affect seafloor algae? First answer is that in some ways, there aren't tons of differences. The first thing is that we found communities were similar across all of our sites. So this is in terms of what species were present. I think we had around 75 species, I want to say, that were present overall throughout all the surveys. And most of those species were present at all of the sites. We didn't end up having sites that had tons of a few species that were only found there, or species that were only found in a different place. Overall, communities were made up of similar organisms. Here's just a picture of a few of them. This is maybe a false photo because there's a different kind of kelp in Southern California than I have on the background, but similar idea. It's kelp that makes habitat. Down there, it's giant kelp, and this is the bull kelp that you'll see more in Oregon. The second thing that we found is that diversity varies by site. So I'm not sure if you all will know this yet. If you've done this in class, great. If not, diversity is a measure of how many different species there are. So if there's, you know, 5 species of fish and 2 species of algae, it tells you that number, but also their relative abundances. So diversity will tell you a combination of things. It's a more holistic view than just the number of species. It gives you more of an idea of how even things are. If there's just a ton of one species and not a lot of any others, that wouldn't be high diversity. If you have a lot of species that are all present in decent abundances, that's going to be a pretty high diversity usually. So what we found is that diversity was different at these different sites. And as you can see on this graph here, we found that overall, those 2 wave exposed sites had higher diversity than the sites that had fewer waves or lower currents. And this is pretty interesting because waves and currents impact ecosystems in a lot of ways. It could be by delivering oxygen, delivering nutrients, keeping the water cool. It could be by delivering, not seeds exactly, but seaweed have really small life history stages that are sort of similar to seeds from a tree. So if you can imagine delivery of these little kelp seeds or seaweed seeds, and also delivery of other things that are important, you get higher diversity overall. And one thing I want to point out on this graph is that there's letters on top of those, each bar. You don't need to worry too much about it, but what those letters tell you is if one bar is statistically different from a different bar. So don't worry about the statistics too much, but the important thing is that we found that there is definitely a difference between the highest wave exposed site and the lowest wave protected site, which is really neat. So this is for sure a trend, and we can confidently say that diversity is higher in places that have more waves and that are higher currents overall. And that's a little Garibaldi fish in the bottom. I think it's the state fish of California. That's a baby. They're really cute when they're adults too, but the babies are really pretty because they have that blue spots. I just like them. All right, next slide. So the next thing that we found is in regards to species richness. So like I mentioned before, diversity is just a measure of how many different species there are and sort of their relative abundances. So it gives a more holistic view. This is just about the number of species. So species richness, you would just count them and say, doesn't matter how many individuals there are, but you can see that there's one type of fish, one type of algae, one type of snails or something like that. And what we found is that there's an even bigger difference when you look at richness compared to diversity, probably because it's a little bit less comprehensive of a measure. So this is a little bit more simplistic in what you're getting, but we found that we also had higher richness in places that had more waves, probably for similar reasons to what I mentioned before. But like I said, this pattern is a little bit more visible, I would say, than the last slide, where the two, the pink and yellow ones, are definitely both lower than the one that has the most highest richness in the wave exposed sites. And that's the blue cavern site. I just realized I forgot to change these, but the blue cavern protected on this slide and the previous slide, it just means perdition caves. That's what I have it as in your worksheets, but don't worry too much about it. Point still stands. So what I have in the bottom right of this slide, these are called strawberry anemones. They're really cute. And in some places they just grow all over the bottom, like a big pink carpet. And it's really fun to look at underwater. So the last thing that I wanna talk about is evenness. And if you haven't talked about evenness yet in your class, it pretty much just is a measure of how uniform the environment is. So you can see on the left, there's a really uniform surface. It's just sand, there's nothing down there. It's all one type of thing. Whereas on the right side, we have less even, I would say. So there's a ton of different things. It's a super heterogeneous or non-uniform environment. There's many different species that are making up this whole environment. And they're also present in different abundances. So you can kind of tell there's like a pink fuzz that's more common than some of the other stuff. And that's just a very different environment. So one thing that we found is that evenness increases with depth. So as you go down, the bottom becomes more just uniform. There's less difference between site photo to photo, and things are a little bit more, I'm not really sure what the best way is to say it, but they're a little bit more uniform overall, less difference between photos and within photos. And so this is kind of interesting because as you go deeper, all of these sites are becoming more similar within photos and also more similar to each other. And one thing that's kind of cool that you can definitely pick apart with this is that if you're at the top, you know, at 0 to 20 feet where the waves are really hitting the walls and there's a lot of turnover and there's more sunlight differences. Like if one site's in the shade, you're going to get a different area. But when you're at 60 feet, these sites are all very, very similar. The waves mostly happen at the top. So any differences in waves, you're not seeing at the bottom anymore. Any differences in sunlight from shading or the direction that they're facing aren't as important anymore because at 60 feet, things are a little bit darker. There's less difference in light. So overall, kind of cool that these, even though the sites are different, they're only really the most different at the top compared to the bottom. So I just think that's neat. And that's most of what I found. To recap, we found that diversity and richness vary with site, and that's probably due to the wave exposure and just current speeds. Also, the communities become more similar with depth, both within a photo and also between sites. So really neat. At the surface, you see bigger differences. This all makes sense because we are talking about seaweeds. And as I'm sure you know, seaweeds need light to photosynthesize. And so areas where you're going to have seaweed are going to be the ones where you have the most light. So as you get down to the bottom, less differences overall. Wave action and sunlight are both important. And that's overall what I found. This sometimes may seem like very basic information, but I like doing this because it's fun to just look at a place and say, why is it this way? Why is this happening? Why are these things here instead of here? And here's an answer. So I really love the process of research because I had a question, I had some numbers, I calculated some things, collected some data, and now I have an answer. And I think that's really great. And from this, I have tons more questions. I could go back and do this whole thing again and probably learn something entirely different. But for now, that's what I wanted to tell you about. I just thought this was a fun picture of an octopus that I saw while I was on one of my dives for this project. And fun bonus photo, this is a sea anemone living on an iPhone that I found underwater while I was diving. Just in there for fun. So thank you for listening. I hope you guys enjoyed this and I hope it adds to your experience in class and working with this data set. If you have any questions, feel free to email me. I forgot to put my email in this, but it's tonrak@oregonstate.edu. T-O-N-R-A-K at OregonState.edu. I'm very happy to do live Zoom sessions or just interact over email. Either one's totally fine, but let me know. Thanks, and I hope you learned something.